So therefore the drik is the seer, the body is seen, the thoughts are seen, all these are seen, therefore it is objectified and therefore it is not the subject. So who is the seer which sees the seen? When you see the seer, the quintessence of meditation is to see the seer. The body is mine, but I am not the body. The thoughts are mine, but I am not the thoughts. The donkey is mine, but I am not the donkey. So too the thoughts are mine, but I am not the thoughts. So therefore through this inquiry, meditation called Drik Drishya Viveka, it is seen, I am the seer. So the body is seen, the thoughts are seen. Who is the seer which is seeing all this? See the seer. Seeing the seer is the quintessence of meditation. When you see the seer in order to see is consciousness. What is seen is consciousness. The seeing is consciousness. Because the seer cannot see if it is not consciousness. So when you see the content of the seer, the content of the seen and the seeing exist in consciousness. Once when you see it exist in consciousness there, now please see, when that happens, then suddenly you experience that I is pure consciousness, which is indeed divine. Hence the Veda says, Aham Brahmasmi, I am indeed Brahma, means I am indeed limitless, I am indeed divine. And therefore, Devasya Savituhu, that divine sun, right, Dhimahi, we meditate. How? Through Drik Drishya Viveka, that I am the Drik, I am not the Drishyam, I am the seer, I am not the seen. When that is there, we meditate on Bhargaha Varenyam, the light of the effulgent sun. Just the light of the effulgent sun. Bhargaha Varenyam means the light of the effulgent sun. So therefore, we meditate on the light of the effulgent sun. Just close your eyes and you will see there is darkness. But again you see there is a light which lights up the darkness itself. That light, it is indeed bright and effulgent. And which is indeed divine, which is indeed the Savituhu. So therefore, Tat Savituhu Varenyam Bhargaha Devasya Dhimahi Diyo Yona Prachodayat. Diyo Yona Prachodayat means Diyaha, our intellect. Naha, for us, not for me. Prachodayat. Prachodayat means enlighten. So Prachodayat means enlighten. So our intellect enlighten. See the selflessness even in the prayer. Not that I have to be enlightened. Therefore if somebody says I am enlightened, it is little ridiculous. Because in enlightenment I disappears itself. So there is no question of I am enlightened. Because I itself disappears enlightenment. For the sake of communication, you can say I am enlightened. But really, I does not exist there. And therefore, this intellect, please enlighten. Why intellect? Because ignorance exists not to consciousness. Ignorance exists to the intellect itself. Not to consciousness. The consciousness is already enlightened. Ignorance exists to whom? To the intellect. And hence, Lord Krishna in the Gita says, Agnyanena tu jnanam avritam tena muhyanti jantavaha. Krishna makes it very very clear. He says, your agnyanena, because of ignorance, jnanam avritam, your intellect is covered, not knowledge is covered. See, even though the Sanskrit meaning is agnyanena tu jnanam avritam, jnanam means knowledge. How can ignorance cover knowledge? So the word jnanam there is not knowledge. Because if knowledge is there, ignorance cannot exist. When light is there, darkness cannot exist. So the word jnanam in the Gita refers to your intellect, because the intellect has the capacity to know, therefore it is called as jnanam. That jnanam is covered by agnyanena, by ignorance. So agnyanena tu jnanam avritam, tena muhyanti jantavaha, Lord Krishna says, because of this people are deluded. So people are unhappy. Why? Because of ignorance. And where does ignorance exist? Not in Atma, not in consciousness, but it exists in the intellect. And hence the whole message of the Gita is, Moha, ignorance. And where does that ignorance exist? In your intellect. And therefore, shokasya karanam mohaha. So therefore, this intellect, diyaha, our intellect, not only mind, our intellect, prachodayat, please enlighten. Once when it is enlightened, ignorance goes away. Once when ignorance goes away, then you will find that atma, ananda, the silence is your very essential nature. If silence, happiness is my essential nature, then why is that I don't experience it? You don't experience this because you are ignorant. Now, why is that I am ignorant? The word why you are ignorant cannot be answered. Because why itself is a product of ignorance. It is like there's a logical fallacy in the question. If you ask me, what time did time begin? I cannot answer this question. Right? Because you're trying to separate time from time. Where did space begin? You cannot answer because where belong to space? Why this ignorance? It cannot be answered. Hence, anarvachiniyam. It is inexplicable. It exists. And because of this ignorance, even though your nature is happiness, you are suffering. The spiritual masters tell us, we are also drunk by the alcohol called ignorance. And therefore, even though our nature is happiness, we are experiencing unhappiness all because of ignorance. And because of ignorance, it does. That's why ignorance is also called as maya. Agatita ghatana patiyasi maya. The impossible is made possible. Even though our nature is happiness, we live a miserable life all because of the great miracle and the magic of this called maya, ignorance. And hence, diyaha, our intellect, prachodayat. Please enlighten our intellect. And enlightenment is understanding the fact of what I am. And the fact of what I am is I am of the nature of Sat. I am of the nature of Chit. I am the nature of Ananda. I am that Savituhu, that sun of consciousness, which is indeed Devasya, which is indeed divine, which is Bhargaha Varenyam, which is indeed effulgent it is. So therefore, enlightenment is seeing the truth of myself. And hence the Veda says, Atma Vit Shokam Tarati. One who knows who I am, Atma Vit, one who knows who I am, my true self, not the body, not the mind, but the pure consciousness, the spiritual center, such a person, shokam tarati. Shokam means the sorrow tarati, he crosses over. Because the moment he knows who I am, then I am silence. I am peace. When I am silence, I am peace, restlessness cannot really emerge. There's a very beautiful story. Listen to the story. It seems a Zen master was about to pray and then he found there was a lot of noise of the frogs. So he goes out, opens the window and tells the frogs, "Oh frogs, can't you realize that a Zen master is praying and therefore you are disturbing the prayer of a Zen master?" And the moment now the Zen master says this, the frogs stopped croaking. It became silent. And then the Zen master sits and starts meditating. When he starts meditating, then suddenly the voice from the sky comes, the Lord's voice comes and says, "Om, you have disturbed the prayer of the frogs. You have disturbed the prayer of the frogs." Then the Zen master realized, the frogs were also praying and I did not realize that. And therefore he goes, opens the door, window and says, "Oh frogs, please continue your prayer." And the frog starts croaking. And then he sits and meditates. And then he says, "The prayer of the frogs has deepened my prayer." So the moment I am centered, I am restful, the external sound cannot disturb the silence. But if I am not centered, even a small thing can disturb. All because I am not aware of the center, that the center in me is silence. If I am not aware, then a person behaves like a drunkard. A behavior.